I'm Neill Quinn, interviewing Gerald Stern in Buenos Aires on the occasion of the 14th Movement Disorder Congress. Gerald is approaching the age of 80, 18 years older than me. You were one of the two original honorary members of the society.
Correct.
And you're delivering the Stanley Farn lecture this year.
Yes, indeed.
And I've been asked to probe a little bit about your early life and things that were important to you. And perhaps starting from the beginning, how did you come into medicine, neurology, movement disorders, and what was your early educational experience?
Well, entering medicine was really a bit of an accident. I had no strong indications that I was going to be a doctor, and my father really wanted me to take over the shop, which he'd worked very, very hard. And he was a very intelligent man, although uneducated, and he perceived that I was innumerate. And when you're selling cigarettes in Bethnal Green, there are no second chances. He could add up 14 items and give the correct change. So there was a family powwow. What are we going to do with this stupid boy? And one thing that the Jewish family in the East End of London wanted was to have a doctor in the family. And I readily acquiesced, because I knew there wasn't a chance of getting a place. Because, you see, these are the post-war years. 12 medical schools in London. Many ex-servicemen coming back wanting to have a career. And my educational achievements at that time were minus zero. So I was confident that I wouldn't get a place. But I loved my parents, and I wanted to do what I could to keep them happy. So I wrote at my father's insistence to the 12 medical schools. 11 of them, to my, I wasn't at all surprised, declined to see me because I had nothing to offer. And rather to my surprise, I got an interview at the London Hospital. And I think this is explicable by the fact that my grandfather's delicatessen was 100 yards outside the London Hospital. It is now a mosque. He was an ardent monotheist, but I think that's going a bit far. And my father's cigarette shop was about 400 yards. So my application showed the address. So I got this interview. And at that stage of my life, I hadn't seen Leonardo da Vinci's Ultima Cena. But it was just like that. There was a long table, there was a chap in the middle, and there was a little stool for me to sit on. And the interview began, and they looked at the papers. I had no educational achievements at that time. And they were, didn't know what to say. And then a chap at the end said, I've seen you before. I had no idea who it was. Now, at that time, I was doing quite a lot of athletics to pass the time. I was a member of Victoria Park Harriers, a sort of county standard athlete. So the whole interview was on athletics. So when I went home, I remember very clearly, it was a Friday night, there was a candle on the table. By the way, Yiddish was the language. My parents spoke very little English. My father said, "Nu," which means in Yiddish, "Well, how'd you get on?" And I said, "Well, look, this was a disaster. Here they are potentially looking for doctors, and we discussed athletics." So they burst into tears, and I felt relieved. But I got a place. And then at medical school, I really couldn't see the point of it all, because this was preclinical stuff. And the only advantage I had was a totally unconsummated memory. I had a very good memory for the simple fact I didn't go to school from 8.5 to 12.5, and it was never used. So I could bone up all the anatomy and origins and insertions. And I only stuck it out, I mean, frankly, I couldn't see the point of it, to keep my parents happy. I think I was the only student who walked from his home to medical school every day.